record. Great, so let's start. So what we're going to do today is to continue in our introduction to evolutionary biology, evolutionary theory, and then we'll start also with some math if we have time today or if not. So what we said last week was that the topic of evolution in what evolution studies is the changes in the in a population that concern heritable variants. So the key point is that we are interested in how variation, but there are two observations here. One observation is that when we look at different individuals, we see differences, whether we are looking at bacteria, humans, mammals, primates, whatever scale, whatever kind of living organism you are looking at, you see differences between individuals. And some of these differences between individuals are also heritable, meaning that the offspring tends to be more similar to the parents on average. Okay? And what evolution studies is how this variation, this heritable variation, changes in a group in a population. What does it mean? It means that we see a population, so a group of individuals, and we follow the generations of this group of individuals, and we track some traits or something we can measure, and we look how these characteristics of individuals change over time. Okay. So this is the sort of the question about evolution is try to understand how these traits, these characteristics, change over time in a population. Okay. So this is the question. And as I said last time, not all the variation we see is heritable. So for instance, if we start training a lot, we build a huge mass of mass, but that is not passed to the future generation. Okay, so that is variation, and we can detect differences within a population, but that is not heritable, so it's not passed to the generation. So it's not subject to evolution. So evolution acts on this heritable variation, and we want to see how these change over time. Now, there are, as you can imagine, there are many sources of variation. So in a mechanistic sense, there are many ways that variation can be present in a population. Okay? What are the sources of variation? So why individuals are not, why there is variation that builds up? So if we start from from one cell which is identical to itself, and we have it reproducing and we have a population, then we start to see a differentiation. Okay, so there are differences between the cells. Why? What are the processes that contribute to this?
Mutations.
Yeah, so one is mutations. There is another one, which is, there are other two. One is easier, one is trickier.
Something like gene expression?
Yes, but that's, okay, that's a complicated topic, yes. But you can imagine that is not happening. Let's say first level, that is variation. So you have different cells, they express different different proteins, but that is not heritable. Okay. This is not completely true in the sense that, for instance, if a cell divides, a bacterium divides, also the protein content divides. So there is a parcel of this heritable. But in general, for instance, if you are thinking it does, we have cells that are differentiated. My liver cell is different from my neuron. In my body, they have completely different gene expression, but that is not what I pass to my generation.
Adjusting to the environment?
Yeah, so adjusting to the environment, this is variation, right? Is what produces, I mean, it's a difference, but it's not heritable. So if I spend, if I live in some environment, I change my body, it has an effect on my body, but that is not something that I pass on the generation. The fact that the environment changed me at the phenotypic level.
Sexual reproduction.
Yes, it's sexual reproduction or sexual recombination. Which is the fact that if you look at your parents, if you have sexual reproduction, you look different from your parents. Right? You inherit something, but you are not a copy of your parents. Right? And you have completely different traits because you are the product of a recombination between the chromosomes. Then there is another one, which is Jim Crow. Which is something that happens in bacteria where basically can pass genes to each other. So they share part of their genome. You have a cell and the cell basically transfer part of the genome to another cell. So that is a source of variation, which is different from the other. But you see that you have these sources of variation, which is something that specific to biology, of course. But in some sense, I mean, you can formulate an evolutionary theory without needing to specify these mechanisms, right? So this is how variation is produced, but it's not something that it's a requirement to have evolution. Okay, so these are the sources of variation. Then, I mean, you have heritable variation. This is something that we see, but also we have changes, right? So evolution studies the changes of the heritable variation. So what are the mechanisms for these changes in a population? Okay, so there are many mechanisms. So there are many reasons why. So the question I'm asking is: if you look at a population, you have a set of individuals, and they are different. They reproduce. You have another set of individuals. They reproduce. They are a little bit different, and you follow them over time. And you ask, what are the traits of this population? How they differ here and in the future, for instance, okay, there is variation that changes, so the population changes over time. This is what evolution studies. And the question I'm asking is why this population is different from that population. Okay, what are the mechanisms, okay, that produce this variation? So one mechanism is which is the most famous one. Is natural selection. And what natural selection does is that if there are some traits, there is some of this variation. Okay, I'm talking about variation in general. Right? If some of this variation confer an advantage to the individuals that get the variation, this variation is going to spread in the population. What does it mean? It means that if the individuals that have some trait are also the individuals that reproduce more compared to the others, you expect that in the future there are going to be more of the individuals that have reproduced more. Okay, having that trait. So you have, let's say, you have a group of two individuals, you have a population and you have two types of individuals. The blue individuals and the gray individuals, okay? So you have the blue individuals, blue, and you have the gray individuals, okay? And then they reproduce, okay? If the gray individuals reproduce more than the blue individuals, okay, they're gonna have more offspring, okay. And then this may produce more. And you see that the number of individuals that are gray individuals is larger than the blue individuals. Okay? As time passes. Okay? Pretty obvious. I mean, seen like this. So if being having a different given trait, having a different type of variation, is associated to reproducing more, to more offspring, you expect that that trait is gonna expand in the population, meaning that there are gonna be more individuals carrying that trait. Is that clear? Okay. And this could be for many reasons. I mean, could be well, because the trait makes you more adaptable to the environment, increase your fertility, etc., etc. Okay. Is it clear, or it looks confusing? What is not clear?
I think the grade must be greater from the beginning.
Well, no. Why? Suppose that not necessary. Suppose that it is possible that, for instance, all the individuals were blue. But then here there was a mutation, okay, and it appeared a gray individual, and then this expanded the population, okay. Or it is possible that the environment here was favoring the blue individuals, but then something changed in the environment, and now it's more favorable for the gray individuals to stay there.
So the environment
The environment can change, exactly. So the environment can determine which variation, which type of variation is subject to natural selection. Okay. So natural selection is not something that is, let's say, equal and constant in all the environments. Okay. It depends on what is the environment that you live in. Okay. If you live in the ocean, it's better to have fins. If you live on the land, it's better to have legs. Okay. Just an example, but the what is better in terms of reproduction depends on what environment you are in. The key point is that this is, in some sense, general, right? As general as it can be. So I'm not saying there is a specific mechanisms that produce. I'm not pointing to specific mechanisms that produce natural selection. I'm just saying if there is some mechanisms for which individuals having a given trait, being of a given type, make you produce more offspring, then the type is going to expand in the population. But that can be for many reasons. And actually, it's very hard to disentangle this. And note that this is, well, no. And so there is a concept that is typically very much associated to natural selection, which is fitness, which all these things I'm going to discuss them in general, then you're going to see them in models. So it is more of a discussion, but to give the breadth and the set of examples. So fitness, you can think it, I mean, this is wrong, but I mean, as a first approximation, you can think it as the the number of offspring an individual the individuals with a given trait have. So what you can think of is if you are a blue individual, the expected number of offspring is, let's say, the fitness of the blue is something around 1.3. The fitness of the gray is around 2.7. Okay, so it means that in a generation, an individual produces on average 2.7 offspring, this 1.3 on average, and so you expect that this is going to expand in the population. Okay. Now, this is a complicated concept because, of course, it's not related to a single individual, it's a property of a population, so it's a property of the typical green individuals. So in practice, you need, I mean, it's not something that it's a property of an individual. It's a property, a statistical property of a population. So you have to define which trait you are looking at, and it's not clearly related to mechanisms necessarily. Anyway, the idea is that you have individuals have a different fitness, so they have a different expected number of individuals based on their traits, and the ones that have a higher fitness, you expect them to expand in the population. Okay. Now, another mechanism called genetic. And genetic drift is, you can think that as just the stochasticity and reproduction, okay? So the point is that when you have a population, even if it's large, there are many variants that are there, okay? So suppose that here you have the first gray individual, okay? Even if this gray individual, which is the first gray individual, let's say that there was a mutation here, okay, this is the first gray individual, and this gray individual have a larger fitness, but if there is, this individual dies by chance, is predated and dies before can produce offspring, this individual doesn't reproduce, right? And therefore, there are not these gray individuals, okay? And even if you're here, you have three individuals. But if all of them die before reproducing, the gray variation disappears and goes. Okay? So the point is that, of course, in the reproduction, you have many random events. And these random events, the fact that you have, you don't produce a constant number of offspring, but you have an average number, and you can die before producing offspring, you can produce more, etc. So you have stochasticity in reproduction. These produce randomness. And these affect the type of variation you see in a population. Okay. So these are actually the two things we are gonna discuss in the models. Actually, these are two important parts of the models. So we're gonna explicitly take into account. There is another main mechanism for the change of traits in a population. Which is sexual selection. Which is the idea that when you have sexual reproduction, what determines which is more advanced, I mean, which trait is gonna reproduce more, is not necessarily something that is related to your ability to interact with well adapted in the world, but it's also your ability to find a partner. Okay. So the individuals that are able to find a partner, to find more partners, are going to reproduce more and they're going to transmit more their traits to the future generation. Okay. And this adds organisms is a negligible effect, but there are some organisms where this is super evident, right? For instance, in birds, the reason why you have colorful birds sing, they do all the fancy things that they do is because there is a huge sexual selection, okay? And in fact, you see that in sexual selection because you see that only males have these traits, right? If you think at the... What's the name of the bird with the big tail?
Peacock,
yes. So if you think of the peacock, the male has this beautiful tail, I mean, this beautiful tail or colorful that is just needed to attract females, okay? And the crazy part about sexual selection is that having a huge tail, if you are not in a park, but if you are in a forest, is a huge disadvantage for escaping predators, etc. But still, the fact that you have a huge tail can signal to the females that you have a good gene repertoire, that you are healthy, etc., etc., and you are more likely to reproduce. Okay? And since you have a beautiful tail, female tends to choose males with that beautiful tail, and therefore they produce more. Okay. But the point is that it's very interesting sexual selection because it goes into crazy directions, right? So you have, let's say, peacock with this huge, colorful tail, which is very disadvantageous for moving around. You have like incredible dances and songs performed by other species of birds. You have huge differentiation between males and females. So for instance, there is this this fish that lives in the bottom of the seas. It's like monkfish. It's similar to a monkfish. It's actually the monkfish. It's a very good fish to eat. But lives in the bottom of the sea. And it's completely different, the male and the female. So the female is much bigger. And what happens to the males is that the males basically attach to the female when they have to reproduce and fuse, are basically absorbed by the female. So basically the female absorbs them and keeps only the reproductive part of the male, yes, it's crazy, of the reproductive parts of the male. And so, and then can have like reproduction as much as she wants. And the reason of that is because this is a crazy differentiation between male and females. And the reason of that is that if you are in the bottom of the sea, what is very hard is to find a partner. Okay. So if you find a partner, then you hook it and you don't leave going there. And other examples are like of crazy sexual selection is like the mantis, right? Or all the insects that where the females eat their partner. Okay. So this is sexual selection gone crazy, where basically the male presents some gift. I mean, it's very common, for instance, between birds that males present a gift to the female, and the more beautiful is the gift, the more likely is that they reproduce. Okay, and for some species of insects, this gift is so extreme that you're basically gifting yourself, right? So the male reproduces and then the female eats the male to have a good source of calories, which is probably, yeah. Yes, and there are all crazy behaviors. So, okay, I'll tell you the last one and stop because it's very interesting. But there is, because I think it's interesting because this signals how all these behaviors that emerge because of these mechanisms there can go in a completely crazy unexpected direction, right? So there are these other insects that basically they give a gift to the female and what they do is that they basically wrap like a smaller insect or something to eat inside inside something. So for instance, if, I think there are spiders that do that, so they basically encapsulate in their neck something to eat. And there are these crazy males that basically cheat on the females. Basically, they don't have a gift to give her, but they make this beautiful box made with their net, but there is nothing inside. So while the female is unwrapping the things, they reproduce and then they escape because otherwise they get. And there are also examples, so most of the cases of sexual selection is differentiated between male and female because typically in the natural environment, females take care of the offspring, and then the males they disappear. But there are cases where it's the opposite. So the males take care of the offspring, and in that case the differentiation is reverted. So the females are the most beautiful, and the males are the ones that have to choose because they are the ones that they are going to take care of the offspring. So. Biology is very differentiated, but the point is that this mechanism here, which is just based on the fact that if you do something different and that something make you reproduce more, produce these incredible bridges. Okay. Any question about this? Yes.
What about asexual reproduction?
Yes, for asexual reproduction, there is not, these mechanisms doesn't apply.
Yeah.
Don't apply, right? Because if you have asexual reproduction, you don't have sexes, right? So you cannot differentiate these two. And in sexual reproduction, the key point is that you have two different sexes and you have to choose a partner. So when you have to choose a partner, the trait of the partner becomes relevant, okay? And therefore this produce a selection pressure on some traits. So if you are if you are a peacock and you have a larger tail, you are more likely to reproduce. And this, you are more likely to reproduce, therefore you reproduce, you pass the genes, and the offspring are gonna tend to have a larger tail, and so on. The reason why I mentioned is that, for instance, if you look at asexual reproducing species, for instance, bacteria, this mechanism doesn't exist. But for sexually reproducing, these mechanisms is very important to explain traits, to explain why there are some traits of some species. It's extremely important. I mean, for instance, if you're interested in birds, this has incredible importance on the traits of what you see, especially in the things. Okay, so good. So these are the mechanisms. What are the outcomes of evolution? Well, there are several outcomes. The main outcome is that we see that we are not just a huge bacterium able to do anything, but there is differentiation, organisms do different things, they look different, etc. But the outcomes of evolution are basically, one is adaptation. So adaptation is the fact that individuals, species, becomes more adapted to the environment. So they are able to survive better in the environment. Okay, so they change the way they look like, their traits, because of the environment, and they are they perform better in that environment. Okay. So that's why there are, the polar bears is white, because it's better to be white to hide better in the snow, while the brown bear is brown, okay? When there is no ice, okay? This is a very simple adaptation. You change the color. There is the famous example of the butterflies in England when there was the Industrial Revolution, that there used to be like white, butterflies that were like hiding on the bark of trees, but then since the air becomes more polluted, trees becomes darker, and therefore became more advantageous for the butterflies to be not to be white, but to become dark. Right? And so the environment changed. In this case, pollution. Trees became darker in London, and this produced a selection pressure. So if you were darker, you were more likely to escape predators, and therefore you were more likely to reproduce. And the darker butterflies reproduce more, produces more offspring, and becomes more prevalent in the population. Okay, and so this was observed during the Industrial Revolution. Okay, this is an example of adaptation. A key point about adaptation, this is extremely important, and I want to stress it, is that the change of the environment is not the origin of the variation, right? It's not that the darker butterflies emerged because the environment was because the trees became darker. So there was already variation. The point is that the change of the environment produced a selection pressure. Okay, but it's not that the darker, the black butterflies emerge because of the change in the environment. Okay, they were already there. There was variation. It just became more advantageous. So adaptation is one of the outcomes. Another big outcome is extinction. But this word I always extinction. So if you have some traits, but the environment changes, and there is another trait which is more advantageous, you can be driven to extinction because you are less fit to an environment. Okay. And the other is speciation. Which is the fact that you can have, we discussed last time about the word species, that species don't exist, but however you define species, you can have that new species emerge. So there are, for instance, if you define species based on their ability to reproduce with other individuals, you can see that there are new species that emerge, so group of individuals that cannot reproduce viably within themselves, but cannot reproduce with the previously existing individuals. Okay. And the key point is that this happens across scales, and time scales. And typically, people distinguish between two branches, let's say of evolution, macro evolution and micro evolution. Which is an arbitrary distinction, but for instance, with macro evolution, people think at the, a question like, let's say, what is the origin of the differentiation between mammals? So for instance, you say, I have the hippo, and I want to know which is the closest relative to the hippo, okay? Which is, what do you think is the closest relative to the hippo? So the animal that shares most of the DNA with the hippo? No? No. You share more than the DNA with the hippo than the dinosaur. Because we are both mammals.
Of course.
No. 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 Dolphin. Yes, the dolphin. Right. So you see this observation, and you want to reconstruct. Okay, what is the common ancestor of the hippo and the dolphin? How they differentiated, etc., etc. Okay. How the common ancestor looked like. Probably it was a terrestrial animal, and then things changed dramatically. So, questions that are very large time scales, okay, concerning speciation and differentiation of large time scales. And then there is the macroevolution, which is at a much shorter time scale and concerned with a population, let's say, within a species, okay. So I don't know, just to say an example, if you're interested in the Omicron variant, that's my problem, right? So you have a variant of, if you don't know about the news, but okay, it's okay. But if you're interested in different variants of, viruses, and you look at how these variants spread in the population, you are interested in microevolution, right? You have a given, a well-defined virus, and there are a few set of mutations, and you want to see how the population differentiate based on these mutations. Okay. So of course this is arbitrary, the distinction between microevolution and macroevolution. It is not a evolution at all scales, but the idea is that you have these two phenomena. So This is, you are looking at differences across very different populations that do very different things, look very differently. And here is within a population of things that look more or less the same, but they differ in some minor details. Okay. So what we are going to focus on is exclusively microevolution. The reason is that it's very hard to do mathematical models of microevolution. Okay. I want to say a few things of blah blah blah, and then I'll stop. So. So I want to say before we move, sort of to demystify some misconception about evolution, because sometimes we simplified view of evolution that comes from like what we read on newspaper, etc. So the main demystification I want to make is that we typically see an evolution as a directional process. Right? So let's say that we look at the history of life on Earth. We start from very simple cells, and then we say we go blah 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 blah, and then we end up with us. Okay. And we say, oh, there is clearly a direction of evolution, and in some sense we think that us are the final product of evolution, while bacteria were the first product of evolution, and there was a directionality toward more and more complex objects. Okay? So this is wrong for two reasons. Well, the first reason is that, of course, evolution is not just happening on this direction of what connects us to bacteria, but also bacteria are evolving at the same time, right? So all the tree is changing in all the tips, right? Everything is evolving all the time. But the other misconception is that somehow there is a directionality towards more complex organisms, that for some reason, evolution always favors more complex organisms, with the idea that more complex organisms are naturally more fit. This is wrong, and this is wrong because becoming more complex, however you define becoming more complex, so I don't know, having longer genomes, having a big brain, whatever definition you use for complex, all this complexity, being able to perform more function, always comes with a cost. Okay? So having a longer genome, if you are a bacterium with a longer genome, you need to pay a cost to have this, to maintain this longer genome. Okay? If you are a mammal with a huge brain like us, you pay incredible costs to pay for this brain, metabolic cost, the cost of carrying out children which are not able to do anything for several years, et cetera, are all things you have to pay evolution. Okay? So depending on the environment, there are some environments where it's convenient to be more complex, and there are some environments where it's not convenient to be more complex, it's actually convenient to become simpler. And in fact, there are several evidences of simplifications, right? So for instance, there are one of the major transitions in the history of life is multicellularity, right? So you started from single cells, which are isolated, and then these cells becomes attached with each other and becomes differentiated. What does it mean? It means that some cells perform the function, some cells perform the other function. So typical distinction, initial distinction is some cells are devoted to take energy, so metabolism, and other cells to reproduction, okay? So you create a group of cells which originally were independent individuals that then becomes more and more they need more and more the others to survive, and they form at the end one unique organism. Okay, so this is clearly becoming more complex, and the advantage of multicellularity is that you can be much more flexible, you can do much more complicated things. There are many evidence across the tree of life of individuals of species, for instance, of yeast, which is sort of yeast has forms that are both multicellular and unicellular. There are some species of yeast that today are in cellular, but if you go back, you know that there was an ancestor of this species that was multicellular. Okay? So there is evidence that it's true, so in some environments it becomes more advantageous to become multicellular, but evolution can also bring you to simplification. Okay. And for instance, there are many another example of simplification is parasites, right? Parasites are organisms that typically becomes much, much simpler than the common ancestor when they start to be parasitic. Because if you are a parasite, you don't need many things, right? You just take advantage of the host you're parasitizing. And therefore, you see like parasites from very different parts of the tree of life that became more simpler and simpler than the ancestors. Okay, so evolution, the message I want to give is that don't think that evolution is something that has a direction that produces more complex individuals. It's something that can produce more complex, less complex individuals as well. Okay. So I think any question about this? Okay. Last thing before the break. What are the I talked about evolution and I gave it for granted. I think it's good nevertheless to say what are the evidence of evolution, right? Why we believe that evolution is actually what happened, and what are the hints, the things that are in agreement with evolution that you can see in the and I want to give this because sometimes in the, let's say, popular culture, the evidences you give are not the right evidence. They are concerned with something that is not really the key point of evolution. So the main evidence of evolution, in my opinion, is examples of what's called poor design. So suppose that you have to create a machine that does something, okay? Then you can think about the project of this machine. You create this machine and you can make it as perfect as you want. Evolution doesn't operate in this way. Okay. Evolution, if you think you want to transform a microwave into an helicopter, but you need to have something that is functioning at all the intermediate steps, right? You cannot like change an individual, take an hippo and transform it into a dolphin, moving things around as you want, right? All the intermediate steps have to be functional, they have to survive in the environment. Okay. This is to say that evolution has huge constraints while it proceeds. It cannot modify things as evolution wants, right? I'm giving agency to evolution. There is no agency. But during the process of evolution, things cannot change freely. Right? There are huge constraints imposed by the fact that you need to have also the intermediate steps functioning things. And so this determines that sometimes the solution found by evolution suck a lot, okay? So a lot, I mean, they still function, but they could be, if we had to design them, we would have designed them in a much better way. Okay. So one example of a clear example of poor design is the eye. The eye of, not all the eyes, the eye of animals. Sorry, not of animals, of mammals, I think, at least. And the point is that you, in the structure of the eye, you have the retina, and you have cells that are the photoreceptors, so the cells that receive the signal from light, okay? And these cells, what they do is they transform the signal into an electric signal that goes to the brain, okay? So here you have light, okay? And in the in our eye, for instance, what you have is that you have the photoreceptors. And so here there is the receptor, okay? And here there is the nerve starting, okay? So here you have a bundle of nerves, and then they go inside the middle of the eye, here you have all the cells. Here you have the bundle of the nerves that go into the brain. Okay? So this is like if you were, there was a good meme that I find. It's like if you were talking to a microphone from the side of the cable, right? So the light is coming from the side of the connection while the receptor is on the other side. Okay. Now, of course, it still works because I mean, you have still light coming here. But what this produces is that you have a blind spot. In the eye, because it's the point where you you have the nerves that have to come. Okay, so this is a very stupid design. Right? If you had to design it, you would have done it upside down. Okay, and in fact, not all the animals have the eyes like this. For instance, the cephalopods, so like the like squids, octopi, etc. They have the eye as you would have designed. Right, they have the eye. Where you have the receptors and they are connected from the brain. Okay. What is the why I'm saying this is an evidence for evolution? It's an evidence of evolution because you you can imagine that you basically started creating, I mean, the eye evolved out of single photoreceptor cells. But the point is that once you have, you're starting building the eye in some way, you start adding a few cells, then it's very hard to change the construction without with a few mutations. So you are trapped in that local solution. And it's very hard to find to make it something different without destroying and reconstructing it. Okay. So the point is that we are stuck with this and we're going to be stuck for this for the rest of our the generations to come, right? And this was not the best solution, but also it's interesting that you find the solution, the best solution obtained in some animals where the eye evolved independently. Okay. And this is in fact another sort of evidence which is convergent. And this is the fact that sometimes you see structures with some differences that evolve independently for different organisms, right? So for instance, here you have the eye of mammals and the eye of cephalopods, and they evolve independently. So there was an ancestor of both that didn't have the eye. Okay, they evolve independently with similar features and different features, okay? Other examples of poor design is, for instance, pregnancy in humans. So, in before modern medicine, like 1.5% of women and kids died before of pregnancy, which is a huge death toll. It's about 2% of the delivery is produced that the mother dies. Okay, so it's a huge death toll compared to other animals. And the reason is that we, as humans, like to have babies with a big brain, because for, I mean, for our species, we have huge brains. But for a baby to pass through the pelvic canal, sometimes there is not space. Yeah, and so that's the reason why. Now, of course, we have that huge brain produced the fact that we invented modern medicine, and we solved the problem in another way. But the point is that this is an example where you have a very, very cool design. Right? You could have just, I don't know, do something else, but the point is that we were stuck with the solution of having babies with big brains and not having the birth canal being large enough. Okay. Because we are a relatively new species, and therefore we didn't have the time to adapt in that respect. There are other examples. So another example is an enzyme that is called Rubisco, which is a protein that is essential for photosynthesis in plants. Okay, and this enzyme is a super ineffective enzyme. So it costs a lot to produce it, and it's very unstable. And it's not the only solution. So, for instance, cyanobacteria, which are bacteria that do photosynthesis, have other solutions, but all the plants have it. Okay, they're stuck with it. They could be much more efficient in terms of energy constraint if they have another protein, but now they are stuck with it and they cannot do anything. Evolution is in this local minimum and cannot escape. Okay. And so these are another example of design. Then other evidence is what is called atavism. Which is the fact that you sometimes, in especially in higher organisms, you still see the effect, the signs of the ancestors in a present organism. For instance, in the DNA. Okay. So what you have, for instance, is that you have species like dolphins that used to be terrestrial animals, and in the DNA they still have the genes to produce legs, okay, or produce fingers. But what happens is not that they lost the genes, they just silenced them. So when they develop, when the embryo develops, they don't produce fingers. Okay. Another example is like some insects like Drosophila. The antennas used to be legs, okay, and so they become antenna because you silence a particular genes that produce legs. What you can do is that you can just without adding any new genes, you can unsilence the gene during development and produce Drosophila with more legs, right? Instead of the antenna. Okay. So you can play with this, or for instance, you have blind species that live like in the depth of the oceans or in caves. So species that don't have eyes, they don't produce eyes because they so dark you don't need them, but they still have the gene of the eye. Okay. So you see that you have a part of the genome, which is homologous code, so it's similar, it corresponds to the genomes of animals that have eye. That all that structure in the genomes is what is needed to produce eyes. But this part of the genome is not read during development, so they don't produce eye. But if you make, I mean, you change the part that decides which the transcription factors, so the proteins that decide which part of the genomes you read, if you turn it on, you will produce the same fish with eyes, okay? Or the same organisms with eyes. So the instruction is there, it's just not expressed. And so this is another evidence because it shows you that yes, you change during evolution, but you still have the signs, the scars of what your ancestor used to be. Okay. And then there are many evidences from comparative anatomy. So for instance, you can compare the body structures of different species, and you see that the wings of bats corresponds to the heads of mice, etc., etc. So you can compare the anatomy and compare basically bone by bone to different species and see that they have the same structure, just with different sizes. You can find evidences in the fossil record. So one of the most famous example is something that I put on Slack, is this fossil that was predicted to be the fossil that was one of the first animals that went from water to land. And when I say predicted the fossil, meaning that they really predicted that there should have been, paleontologists were in quite good agreement that there should have been a fossil with these characteristics found in a particular range of places that would have corresponded to this first animal that went from sea to land. And they predicted this and they found it. So basically, meaning that you can actually expect what kind of observation you want to do. And then, last for all, these are all evidence from macroevolution, so this to evolution at the larger scale. Macroevolution have been observed, so there are, for instance, examples of speciation. So there were species that were not that were individuals that were the same species, able to reproduce with other individuals, and then via isolation and over time they became two different species. This, for instance, there is an example of some species of lizards in Croatia. So there was an island without lizards. They put some lizard of a given species, and then they came back after 30 years, and these species completely changed, and also became incapable of reproducing with the ancestors. So it has been observed. Okay. So questions. So I wanted to do this. Now we're going to be closer to writing models and do some math. But I wanted to do this because I could have started from the model, but I think is that you have overview, very compressed, very run through, but you have an overview of the range and the breadth of evolutionary biology. Okay, so if there are no questions, I would say we take a break for 7 minutes and other questions? Okay. So here the evidence that I gave very rapidly are evidences, the ones that I discussed, are evidence for, let's say, are observational evidence, so are evidence of something that you observe, right, in the world, from the fossil record, from comparing existing organisms, and is an observational evidence that was mostly directed toward microevolution. I want now to describe, that I already started describing, but I think it's interesting to describe a couple of experiments in that are, let's say, at the boundary between microevolution and macroevolution. The key point is that the message I want to give is that evolution and the product of evolution is not something that you can only observe in the world. So you go out and you try to see among the living organisms evidence for evolution, but it's something that you can produce in the lab and you can do evolutionary experiments in the lab. So the first example is something that I will not fully explain in class, but I'll something that you have to watch. So it's a video that I'll send you on Slack where you can see microevolution happening on the time scale. It's speed up, it has been speeded up, but so the experiment is very simple. You have a huge table for bacteria, and what you have in this table is that you have different sections of these tables. And here you have concentration equal to zero of antibiotics. So here you don't have antibiotics. Here you have a concentration of one in some unit of measure of antibiotics. Here you have 10. Here you have 100. And here you have 10, 1. Okay. So you have at extreme, you don't have antibiotics. In the center, you have antibiotics. Okay. And you start putting some cells here, okay, coli, and then you watch and you let them grow. Okay, so there are also nutrients. And what you're going to see in the video, actually, I'll send you the video. What you're going to see in the video is that you have the bacteria that grow, then they stop here, and then there was a point somewhere here where a cell had a mutation, was already carrying that mutation, and that cell produced offspring, and you have the population that is spread here. And then again and again, and at the end, you have a population that is able to grow at very high concentration of bacteria. Okay? And you can see, and if you were putting a bacterium here, you were probably, that would have been killed. So this is something I'm gonna send you on Slack, so you can still watch. Then I want to discuss two experiments that are almost macro evolutionary. So one experiment is actually very simple to discuss. Is done with the Drosophila, which is does this middle fruit fly, this fruit fly. And what they did in this experiment is that they took these fruit flies, the beauty of my heart, and they took a population, a clonal population, so all the individuals that share the same genome, and they put half of the population in an environment where they gave them starch to eat, and another population where they gave maltose to eat. Okay? So, two different nutrients, two different food, and then they stay there, they reproduce, then they select past population here, and they gave them again starch, and the population here maltose. And they kept going and going for several generations. I don't remember the number. I don't understand the number here. I'll tell you. So they waited several generations. And then what they did was to put the individuals together and look at the offspring. Okay? The point is that this population didn't produce offspring, or the offsprings were not viable. Meaning that the two population became different enough that the offspring they produced were not able to reproduce anymore. So were different species according to the criteria we set. And this was done just by having them living separately for a long enough time in two different environments. And so the key point is that this is extremely important because it shows you that you take organisms which are way more complex than bacteria, in this case they are fruit fly, in different environments, and after a large number but not a still something that you can manage in the lab, you get populations that are not able to reproduce with each other. So you have two populations which are distinct, right? And then what is going to happen to them is they became two different species in some sense, okay? And then they are subject to evolution in two different paths. Any question about this? Yes.
How can one distinguish between the two?
You can label them, you can sequence them. So, but also you can label them. And you can take one fly. If you are a fruit fly biologist, you know which is a female, which is a male, and you can pair them. It's not that you put all the old population. So I guess what you do is that you take one male and one female from the two populations, and then you look at the offspring. Questions? There is another experiment which is very rich, still going on. And I mentioned during the break, this experiment started from a guy named Richard Lenski in 1998, which is, and this guy is still doing the experiment nowadays. So what he did in 1988, he started basically a serial dilution experiment. So the same experiment we described a few lectures ago with bacteria. So he took a flask with cells and some nutrient, very simple nutrient. So let's say what's called minimal medium. So a type of food that is the minimal amount you require, you need for bacteria to grow. So you had cells that were all equivalent to each other, they were around population, and then let them grow for 24 hours, and then dilute and start again. Okay? And he did that for 12 different populations. So he started with two chain of experiments in parallel, 12 chains of experiments in parallel, and then he started with this experiment. So it's since 1988, so 33 years that is going on. Every day there is someone that takes this and does this. Now, the cool thing about bacteria is that you can do them many things. So for instance, you can take a sample, freeze it, and then you can unfreeze it another time and make it grow without any issue. You can also shut down the experiment today if there is a natural disaster and start again from the point where you stopped in 2 weeks. But still, yes, there is someone every day that does this job. And the phenomenology you see, it's incredible. So the first thing is that you can look at the growth rate of this bacteria. So you take one bacterium from a given time, and you see how fast it grows. Okay, so you have this bacteria, this experiment going on from 1988, so you have 30 years of data. You have about 75,000 generations. Okay, so you can look at a bacterium at a given generation. Okay, so took like the first day, it took in 1994, in 2001, 2010, and see how fast it grows on the same medium you're using. And what you see is that if you said this is one, okay, the original population, what you see is that it's doing like this, and you don't see a plateau. So the bacteria today are still getting faster and faster in that environment. Okay, this was something that was unexpected. People expected to reach some to have some adaptation and then stop, but actually you see, even in this relatively simple organism, even in this relatively simple environment, things that are going faster and faster. Okay, it's growing slowly, sublinearly, approximately logarithmically, but you don't see a problem. That's very clear. And then there were many, well, today it's about 1.7, which is a huge change. And then there were many things that happened during this experiment. So one thing that happened is that in a few populations, about six, the population basically increased about the mutational rate. So they started becoming much more diverse and evolving much more rapidly, which was something unexpected. And you see that it appeared in different populations. Then in one replicate number two, there appeared two different strains that coexist at the same time in the experiment. And so there is one strain, S, that helps this bacteria by metabolism. So produce something in their metabolisms which help the growth of this S. And this S produce a toxin that kills L. Okay. This feedback loop. So if this grows, this grows more, but then this suppresses this. So this creates a coexistence between the two strains. And basically the two strains coexist. So you have a population of bacteria, which is you have a population S and L, which persists over many generations. Okay. So you have started from a population that was cloned, and now you have two different subpopulations that interact with the other in a complicated, non-trivial way. Then another phenomenon that appear is that the population started to be able to grow on citrate, which was something that was present in the medium and something that the population was not able to grow on. And basically, in one of the populations, you had these bacteria that were able to exploit one resource that was present in the environment that they were not able at all to use. Okay, and you actually you can track that. It's very interesting that if you look at the population over time, so over generations, you see at a certain point that it emerged these traits. That as the gene to I just go plus that is able to digest citrate. Okay, so this population from that moment started growing on citrate and became more advantageous. Then you can take a population from here, okay, and put it in the same environment. And this happened only in one of the 12 experiments. But if you take a strain from here, and you start another experiment, okay? It's very likely that these at a certain point also produce the start to be able to digest cyanide. What it means is that here you have a complex trait, which is the ability to grow on these metabolite, okay? And you see from there that they start to be able to grow that. But actually this complex trait came from other mutations that accumulate over time, okay? That were not allowing the bacteria to digest citrate, but they were already present, okay? In most of the genomes. They were doing perhaps something else. But then at a certain point, this mutation accumulates and made it possible to emerge this complex trait. But if you start a little bit earlier than when the complex trait emerged, you already have many of these mutations. So you're very close to be able to develop this trait. And if you do evolution again from this point, you see the trait emerging quite inevitably. But this is a very cool experience because you see, again, for bacteria, but you see evolution on time scale, which are very, very long compared to terms of number of generation, and what you see is that evolution doesn't stop, and you have complex traits and complex phenomena in terms of differentiation that emerge. Okay. Question about this? Okay. So what I'll do is okay. So this is the end of today. So this is the end of the introduction, and starting from next time, what we're going to do is to, as I already mentioned, study a population of individuals, so a group of individuals which differ in some respects, so there are different subtypes, and we want to see how the frequency of these subtypes change because of natural selection, drift, and because new mutations appear. Okay, so the things that we are gonna focus on the next lectures is the combination of the effect of mutation, genetic drift, and natural selection. Okay, in principle, if we have time, I also like to do something about recombination, but we will not have time, so this is something I wish. I cannot okay, questions, comments, something else? Okay, good. See you on Wednesday.